that we have a very large underclass. Where is that going to go?
Exactly. And that is the real question in my view. The problem for us is not how to expand the middle class, but how to deal with the problems of the poor, how their poverty and misery can be visibly reduced. That's a challenge which we have failed to address in the last two decades, I would say in the last six decades. In the last 15 years since liberalization began, we've fooled ourselves that growth alone will take care of their problems. It doesn't. It never does. Okay.
To what extent India's internal fault lines of caste, class, religion and regional power and abject poverty will limit its role as a superpower?
Well, with all the qualifications that I have already made, I mean, I don't want India to become a great power, but I think it does hobble India. Some of these problems do hobble India from playing a more positive role in the world. Let me put it this way. And of course they do. We haven't been able to address some of our regional issues of regional aspirations, of separatism in Kashmir or in the Northeast. And that has certainly made India very, very vulnerable. For a long time, we got into this terrible relationship of rivalry and hostility with Pakistan over Kashmir. And I think that held India back from playing the kind of role it should have played in this region as its largest nation, as a country which could afford to be generous to others and to build a strong economic relation. You know, this is the only part of the world, South Asia, where more than 1.2 billion people live. Is the only part of the world where you don't have a free trade agreement, where you don't have a regional trade bloc or serious economic cooperation. And I think that's partly India's fault. And you're right, these issues have kept India, limited India from playing that role.
The issue of caste is still playing. People are playing the caste card, and the politicians are playing. Even the people who want change in the world, in this part of the world, are playing the caste card.
I would qualify this. You see, there are two angles to caste. I mean, there is the traditional hierarchy, and there are people who want to maintain that hierarchy. But there are others who see that the lower castes, the former untouchables, and the lowest orders of Indian of the hierarchy are beginning to assert themselves. So when they assert themselves, it might temporarily take the form of appealing to caste, but in reality, it's a much more emancipatory agenda. So I would, now what you're seeing today is this massive self-assertion of the backward caste classes, right? The Dalits, who were the former untouchables, who form 15-16% of the population, and the what are called the OBCs, the lower orders of Indian society, which includes both Hindus and Muslims, and a certain amount of Christians as well. Who just will not accept anymore the full domination of the upper caste and their monopoly over jobs, over positions of power and authority in every single field in this country. So this is a major, and you know, this has a good democratizing component. And although it might appear to be just a form of casteism, it is not.
Okay. What are the best or worst case scenario for India in 2025?
It's very hard for me to give. But I mean, if we can build societies which respect human dignity, which are relatively equal, where human rights are honored, where there's genuine participation of people, there's openness, there's and freedom of expression and respect for diversity and plurality. That would be my ideal. I don't care so much about how much GDP per capita we have. The worst case scenario is that of a society which is so divided, between rich and poor, between backward regions and advanced regions, between the Bangalores, and which are glittering examples of success, and the boondocks just outside Delhi, the Badlands, where crime alone thrives, right? So if this carries on, this country may not even hold together. You're going to have fissiparous tendencies. You're going to have people demanding that a new state. That kind of, and that it'll be a very unhappy society with tremendous social discontent, with, you know, gender inequalities growing, with prejudice, ethnic prejudice, you know, dominating people's minds, and, you know, and the spreading of hatred. And that's not the kind of thing I'd like to see.
What are the worst or best case scenario for India in 2025 in terms of North-South relations?
You mean the global North and the South?
Global North and South.
The worst, of course, is that the present situation continues, that you have more and more inequalities being promoted through trade. And I do not want the Doha round of trade negotiation in the WTO to succeed in their present form, because they're going to lead to greater inequality, they're going to lead to job losses both in the North and the South, especially in the South, and they're going to destroy livelihoods, right? Mm-hmm. If this continues, then I think you're going to have a nightmarish scenario where, you know, I mean, let's put this in perspective. At the end of the World War, Second World War, average income inequalities between North and South were 30 to 1, mm-hmm. right? The North was 30 times richer than the average person in the South. By the 70s, mm-hmm. this proportion had doubled, 60 to 1, and now it's more than 100 to 1. You can theoretically have even 200 to 1, but political consequences and the social consequences will be disastrous. So, the other thing is to really accept reform, and that means finding alternatives to this bankrupt free market neoliberal model of economic policy making, and looking for alternatives that are based on equity and justice, and then creating a whole global society which cares and shares. Mm-hmm. You know, that's in my view the desirable scenario.
What kind of relationship do you see between India and Pakistan in 2025, and what is the shape of South Asia going to be?
If the present dialogue process between India and Pakistan, which was launched in 2004, continues and scores successes, then I see a very bright future for both India and Pakistan and for South Asia as a whole. This very large region of the world will be at peace with itself for the first time in decades. It can then begin to address the real issues that are relevant to its the bulk of its population. I see this as a very positive outcome indeed. But for this, you need a vision. You need a generous attitude towards your neighbors as well. And why the peace process has moved in a rather halting fashion is because we are not able, our leaders are not able to sustain that vision fully. But one doesn't need to be despondent. But the bad scenario is that, and it could equally happen, is that the peace process comes to a halt because of mutual suspicion or because forces inimical to it prevail. I'll give you an example. There is the world's highest altitude conflict and the world's most strategically absurd conflict too being fought in the Himalayan heights at a place called Siachen Glacier, which is like 20,000 feet above sea level. Right. You know, India and Pakistan are spending, you know, hundreds of millions of dollars to sustain that conflict, which has absolutely no strategic consequences. Who wins or loses makes no difference, right, to either. Now, there were three times near solution, including the last time was just 2 months ago, but the Indian army, which has occupied the heights at Siachen, wants those positions to be demarcated. You know, it vetoed the peace process, the solution to Siachen. Now, this must not be allowed to happen. Mm-hmm. And in fact, what happened was really dangerous. The army chief of India called the press, took a whole bunch of journalists to Siachen and said, look, we are not going to surrender. I mean, he has no business doing that. Mm-hmm. He is not the policymaker. Mm-hmm. It's a civilian authority to which he must defer. And he didn't do that. So, you know, if this happens, then of course you have disaster waiting for us.